I was not a art major when I started here. I was interested in sociology and psychology and interpersonal dynamics, things like that, communication, presentation, speaking, things like that. And I figured, actually my husband said, you should probably take a class to offset the paper writing and the studying and all that sort of activity. And so I was like, that's probably a really good idea. I don't want to spend all this time in one part of my brain and not access the other side of my brain. And also, for a very long time, I had been able to see how I wanted an image to look when I took a photograph. I didn't have a fancy camera, just an old crappy camera, but I couldn't make that happen. I didn't know how to make that happen. I would imagine it, I could see it, I would visualize it, I would look at something, and it just didn't happen. I didn't know how to do it. And so I took an intro to photo class here, and then that started the ball rolling. And then my second semester, I took a class with Tom, and that just, it was a runaway train after that point. I just couldn't stop it. So after a couple semesters, I switched my major, and like Joan said, then I transferred to SAIC. But I wanted to start off showing a little bit of work from when I was here. It was done in the darkroom, but then I scanned it and put it in here. So I was interested in the idea of home, what a home is, what a building is, what energy it holds. Is it the objects in a home? Is it the people that inhabit it? What happens when they inhabit it no longer? What sort of power does it have? Does it have any? Does it exist only in our memories? That sort of thing. And that stemmed from the fact that I was raised in a very strict religious household, and my access to information and people was cut off. It was very limited. I was told what I could read, what I could watch, what I could wear, who I could talk to. And so, naturally, I'm a curious person. I wanted to know what existed beyond that little window that they gave me, and they were kind of editing everything out for me. So I wanted to know what was on the other side. And when I left home when I was very young and I found out what was on the other side, that meant I had to leave everything else behind. My parents, my sisters, my home, all the people I knew, my belief system, like everything had to be recreated again, organically from start. So I think that's why I had the idea in my head that home was an interesting topic for me to investigate, because now I had to create one of my own and then create my own family and create my own world. So these are from the beginning of that time period when I was interested in investigating these ideas. Like I said, originally they were silver gelatin prints done in the darkroom. And I was visiting places that were no longer inhabited to, kind of as a metaphor, using it as a metaphor or a stand-in or of loss or abandonment or emptiness, but also thinking about the themes of what happens when something's no longer used. Does it lose its value? Or what value can it be given by somebody else in a different context? Someone else coming in with a new plan for the space, with me with a camera saying, I'm going to make this into something. This is going to be something else, and I'm going to make it be that way through this medium.
Mira, did you ever change the environment before you shot it, like move things?
Most times I didn't. In this instance, I did. The empty frame was on the wall, and I picked the picture up off the floor and put it in there. I felt it had more of a charge with that there. But generally, I left things alone at that time period because I felt it gave me enough. So then they had portfolio day here, and I brought work in, and all the schools were here, and I brought my portfolio, and SAIC accepted the portfolio and said, send your application in, do all that kind of stuff, and we'll see what happens. And I had not really thought about where I was going to go next. I was still deep in what was happening here. But when that happened, I figured this is a good opportunity. I've been in Western Massachusetts for a while. I'm ready for something different. A different environment is always a good thing for me. It gets something moving in a really different direction, and I was excited about that happening. And so they accepted me and gave me a really good scholarship, and so my husband and I picked up and moved to Chicago, which was never a plan. I've lived in a lot of different cities, never thought of living in Chicago. But the school looked great, the facilities were amazing, and I thought, let's just do this. We'll try it, see what happens. And that was an interesting change from the photo department at GCC to the photo department at SAIC. And I'll talk a little bit about that. But before I left, I knew I was leaving in August, to move in there for August 1st. So there are certain places that I like to photograph in this area. So that entire summer, when I wasn't packing or trying to say goodbye to friends, I was photographing all the time. I took so many rolls of film because I wanted to take this archive with me and bring it with me and then reinterpret it there or see how others would interpret that differently than how it was interpreted here. So I went to SAIC with a lot of film, and this is some of it. And they had a multi-level transfer class, which is to help people that are transferring there kind of get into the groove of how that school works. And also, it's multi-level, so anybody at any photo level in the SAIC photo department can take that class as well. So it's nice. You get new people. You get people that are established and already been there. You have people that are trying out a photo class, and they can all kind of come together and share their ideas. So obviously, I'm still interested in these same themes, using color film now. And I sort of hit a brick wall at SAIC. It was really interesting. There was a very established aesthetic, and there were things like hot topics that were popular to talk about. Ways of looking at photos that were really popular to talk about, and things that went outside of that realm were not really given a fair shot, I felt. And this applied to a lot of different areas, not just what I was photographing or what I was talking about. So I had to work really hard to figure out what I was interested in, to sink my teeth in and say, this is something that's important to me, it's something that means something to me, I'm going to keep making this. I just have to find a way to express that to you successfully and to make the work do it as well. So it was a, sure.
Square, what size camera did you use?
A medium format, it was a Hasselblad. So the great thing about SAIC is they offer so many different ways of handling photography. It's like, you should look at lighting. You have to think about the lighting. So this is all the equipment associated with lighting, and that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to learn about lighting. And there's also large format classes, took one of those. There's alternative processes where you can make cyanotypes, Van Dyke brown prints, platinum prints, all sorts of, any chemistry that you can buy, you can use it in the non-silver room. So I figure I'm here, I should take advantage of this, they have a lot to offer, I should learn how to do some things. So this was part of a lighting project that I did where a friend of mine, we would go to hourly motels in Chicago and set up all this lighting equipment and shoot these really bizarre spaces that just felt icky to be in, but it really, I felt, why not, let's just do this. So I kind of felt that the setup and the things that you need to bring with you were characters in it, and it was meta photography, you know, photography about photography. This is the lighting setup. This is obviously a gel. These are the stands and the tripods and all that kind of stuff. just experimenting and trying different things. So I felt I wasn't getting what I needed entirely from the photo department, and I was interested in trying something else, and so I started taking foundry classes, which is pouring metal. You make objects in wax or something else, you dip it in the ceramic shell, which forms a hard mold over it, then you burn out the wax, and you pour metal into it. So they have this nice program called Oxbow, which is where you go out into the woods in Michigan and you take art classes. Of all sorts, they have all sorts. But they do have an outdoor foundry, which was amazing. And there's us pouring bronze into sand molds with a very tiny crucible. There's a much bigger one at the school, but this isn't a full facility there. And this is an iron pour. They do an iron pour every year in Lake Bluff, which is a big, huge farm out in the woods. And we all go there for an entire weekend. We set everything up. We transport everything there. We set everything up. We pour metal. And then we take everything down and bring it all away like we were never there. It's incredibly intense and exhausting and amazing. But that's me. And that's the furnace with the molten iron coming out of it.
So are these all art students?
Or yep.
Who is running the foundry?
The teachers come with us, some of them, and then some of the SAIC alumni who have started their own foundries actually in Chicago and are have successful art foundries there. They're the bosses of the situation, and we're the worker bees. But I get to go back any year that I want to the iron pour.
Oh, really?
As an alumni, yeah, that's the nice part, yeah. But it makes you a really tight-knit group. Really, really tight-knit group. And that appealed to me. And also just listening to people talk about 2D images, because I would take my work into the sculpture department and we would talk about it there. Or I would combine sculpture with photograph and just photography, and hearing people talk about it in the sculpture department was entirely different than hearing them talk about it in the photo department. And that was so helpful to just see how different people with different experiences look at this, how different makers. This is some of the cast bronze pieces that I made, where I was always using an organic material to start, so this was things that people had written me, and letters and notes that were crumpled up, dipped in wax, and then I got to burn them out in the kiln. I also did a piece with Jamie's hair, where I made something out of his hair, dipped it in wax, and then burned it out. This idea of transmuting something into something else, these messages that have power, his hair that has like all this memory and all these other connotations to it burned out. It was interesting to me to then turn that into a solid metal object and to think about what that might mean.
If those were old letters, why don't we see more of the bends? They seem soft, you know, where paper would have a sharp edge.
I dipped them in wax so many times that it became just an organic shape. And this is the same thing. Just not with, I used an old Bible and then twisted the pieces and formed it into this and dipped it in wax.
And then size of the piece?
Oh, it's approximately this big. Yeah. And ultimately, I would like it to be part of a performance. It hasn't been used that way. There's a hole in the back so it can be mounted on the wall. And then I had an idea of wrapping my hair into the piece and having it hold me there and just see how long I could make the duration last with it holding me. Thinking about what that Bible meant with my family and then holding that tie to me. And there's just close pieces.
I'm remembering a piece you did using strings in the Bible.
Yeah.
in one of the classes. Very different, but
yeah.
these long strings, and I can't remember what they were attached to.
They were attached to the Bible on the podium. Yeah.
Right, from the Bible.
The altarpiece that I made with the pieces of me. So then I decided I don't really photograph people, and I don't generally work with people in collaboration, so I'm going to do that. And Alex was the foundry manager in my foundry class, and he agreed to help me. We were going to explore like interpersonal dynamics, so and intimacy, just kind of like what does that mean? Well, the same way that I was interested in what is a home mean? It's like, okay, but what about people? People interacting with one another, what does that mean? So I went over on a couple occasions, and the first shoot I decided what was gonna happen, the second shoot, I'm like, we both need to kind of decide what's gonna happen and just take a look at this. And so we were just staging ourselves. Basically, we were just hanging out and talking, but I had a automatic shutter release and a digital camera, and I tried to capture some kind of interactions between people. It felt like part performance and part of a collaboration for photography. So then I'm returning to the same ideas before, but just in a different place. I found that putting myself in a different space makes me look at things differently. And these felt more like documents to me. Had less of a charge of the original ones, but I still felt I needed to hold on to that original idea and see where it wanted to go. I felt the objects had power. And then there was a digital imaging class where everybody was learning how to do these amazing things with Photoshop, and I wanted to sort of explore what can I do with my camera. That I can work on it in Photoshop and make it a final image, but the medium format with the Hasselblad, you can take the back off and advance the film only a little bit, and so you can expose one piece of film many, many times. So I was going to different environments and putting these environments together in the camera. Thinking about the structures, but also about what was left behind and also what I was interested in originally. It was interesting for me to think about having the ability to take apart a space and put it together in a different way. Just rearranging the architecture just with the camera and with my ability to edit out what I'm looking at. I was happy with that, and then I wanted to try to do it with color and push it. See what else can I do with this? Because it hadn't started out as a thematic idea per se, but I was like, well, what can I do with this? I'm interested in this, I like this, I've latched on to something, I want to see where I can go with it. And so I started combining the multiple exposures with straight images to see how they would talk to each other, what would happen, how they would influence one another, if they would influence one another.
This is two negatives.
Some of them are four or five, though. It just depends on how many times I've advanced it or what I'm looking at. Because I don't know ultimately what it's going to look like, but I can make a fair guess that if I expose it this way and I only roll it this much, then I'm probably going to get some of this and some of that. So being in Chicago, I realized that people react to me in a certain way because in the summertime when I have a tank top on, I'm very heavily tattooed, and people think a lot of things about that, and they're not afraid to say that to you, whether you're on the train or walking down the street. It's been a source of frustration to me for a long time that people feel that they're allowed to tell me that I look like I'm dirty, or it's disgusting, or why do you ruin yourself? And then I thought, well, I've never really been, I don't care what you think, this is my skin, I own it, but I just thought about the ideas that we have about what's girl appropriate, and this ended up happening because I went to Blick and I bought some foam core to mount some photographs on, and someone for some reason put a jar of pink paint in my bag. And I thought, I'm never gonna use this, I should just throw it out, but I kept it. And I thought, I'm gonna cover myself in girl appropriate material. Like, see, I'm making myself pink. It started out as a photograph, and then I took it into class and I thought, it's not dynamic enough, it's not doing what I want it to do, it's not saying what I want it to say, what can I do? So I applied this pink, I got this pink latex to put on as another skin to cover myself. So the video is me applying the latex to my skin, which I found out dries clear, so it wasn't serving its purpose. So then I covered myself in pink paint over that. And then I had to rip it all off, which was an incredibly painful and smelly process because the latex smells like ammonia so bad. And I had to do it twice because the first time I tried to shoot it standing up and that didn't work. But I felt like at the end I was really happy with how it demonstrated that point, and everyone that watches it cringes. It's just the sound of the ripping and the scraping and trying to take it off is exactly, it wasn't my intention to have it work out that way, but it just hit the nail on the head. It really did what it needed to do. So I'm going back to the multiple exposures and working in this way, combining the images. And I started thinking about how as soon as I left home, I started having dreams about large spaces, these impossible spaces. There are staircases and doors and windows and rooms that I would wander, what seemed like for hours in my dreams, just exploring. They were falling apart frequently, most times, and they became this thing that was uncomfortable at first, and then I became really used to it. And I still have them. It's been over 25 years, and I still have these dreams about wandering through these spaces, and I actually look forward to them now. But I thought maybe this is a way of me creating these impossible spaces. You know, maybe this is why, one of the reasons why I'm really interested in this way of working is that I can make what happens there happen here, and it feels like a way of me mapping or charting a course when I'm doing this. I'm taking control of the situation that I wander through by creating it in this way and making it be this way. I'm not trying to make it the same, but I'm trying to look at all the different perspectives at the same time, like happens in the dream. Or like in cubism, you're just like getting everything at once and making something that's kind of impossible. I was also using portions of photographs that I had taken before, so because I was thinking, how else can I illustrate this with it having it not just be multiple exposures? Because that gets kind of redundant after a while, and it gets really, really overwhelming because it's just too much information. It's way too much. So how else can I do it? Well, I can do it by photographing spaces that lend themselves to seeming that there's more than there than meets the eye. So you can, using mirrors or windows or the way the light is working, you can make something look different. Or this one is a portion, a very small portion of a photograph that I had taken years ago, which I then blew up, isolated that section, and I thought, this does what the other things do. But it's basically just a large part of a straight image. This is also a portion of a straight image. George Washington painting with his Freemason apron on. So I came back to one of the places that I photographed a lot, and what I was noticing is that over the past 5 years that I've been photographing in this space, things always move around. There's a lot of objects that were left there, beds, tables, lamps, phones, everything. And it's always reconfigured. And I thought, well, this is kind of interesting because I get to witness this. It's this space that doesn't serve a purpose anymore, but I get to see what people are doing to this space. Maybe I should document that. And so first I started documenting that, and then I started intervening. I'm like, I'm going to change this. They did this, but I'm going to change it and see if they respond to that. So I wanted to go back after I had changed. I'll photograph the original thing as it was, photograph it as I change it, and then photograph when I go back to see what's happened to it. Some of them are more simple and some of them are more complicated. There was one time we could barely get through a hallway because there had been so many televisions stacked in the hallway that you could barely get by. I also wondered who these people are. Like, who are they, the people that go there and move everything? Because I know people go to spaces and photograph, but who's breaking the walls and moving things and stacking things and changing the beds around and the tables? What's that about? Old TVs are very heavy.
So this was an old motel? Or?
Yeah. And that's where I ended up, just trying a lot of different things and learning how to do a lot of different things. And then being in an environment where I got to talk to people that were amazing to talk to. It was great. The visiting artist lecture series was amazing. Seeing why other people do what they do and what their process is and how their thought process works when they approach something. And also just having access to facilities that gave me a lot of opportunities to do things I wouldn't have been able to do otherwise or may not have even thought of doing. So, and it got me interested in the idea of teaching, which is why I'm applying to grad school. Being immersed in that environment is something that I want so bad. I really do. I want to be part of that community. It was great to be there as a student, but I'm really excited about being there as an instructor as well. So I'm looking forward to that. Hopefully soon. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions or comments?
She hasn't talked about graduate school. What she's thinking of.
What I'm thinking of? Like what?
Future graduate school, for instance, you're going to get it. I think that's important to show where you are, where in Chicago and on. You're also married to a painter.
I am, yes. A painter that I always want to collaborate with.
It's not very eventful to be great.
Yeah, I mean, I think that my experience at SAIC made me want to be a teacher.
More education.
Yeah. Yeah, just immersed in that. That's the part that was so exciting for me was the total immersion. You know, always going to shows, knowing what's happening, talking to people all the time, not just in school, but after, you know, meeting your instructor after and like talking about things and looking at work. And even now, staying in touch with those instructors from GCC and SAIC and having them look at work and talk to you about it and being able to have that conversation still, because that's what's hard when you leave school, is that who do you talk to about it? You know, you don't always have husband that's a painter that went to school that's interested in art that wants to go to shows with you and has something to say about it. Or you want to be able to talk to a lot of different people and get a lot of different ideas and feedback and look at what they're doing and go see their shows. So it's really something that is important to me and I want to be a part of for the rest of my life. I don't want to leave that world. And I'm thankful to GCC for making that world happen.
I think from the very beginning when you talked about home, this idea of home and space and where you are, it seems like it's part of your whole life thing.
Now. Oh, yeah.
Not just your artwork, but your artwork is your life.
Yeah.
Including the skin, this idea of being comfortable in one's own mm-hmm. skin, because that's also your home. And
right.
changing it and painting over it and taking it off and all that seems to be like a life
yeah.
process.
And I mean, and it was good for me that I'm really glad that it was very uncomfortable taking it off. I'm glad that it hurt so much because it felt like this reclaiming. You know, it's like you can say whatever you want or think whatever you want. You can heap all that on me, but it doesn't matter because I don't care. You know, this is mine. And even if I cover myself up and say, does this look better? Is this what you want? Then I can rip it all off and I can say, well, that's too bad because it's mine.
I saw the video in Chicago, and I don't remember. Did you do a performance? That performance at the opening?
No.
That was not part of
no. the no. It was a. It was the video with the headsets, and then there was a photograph, a close up of the skin peeling off my skin, and then a jar on a shelf at the bottom with all the skin coming out of it. Which people took for some reason, like, ew, okay. Sure, you can have it if you want it, but it's just like latex and paint and it was on my skin, but sure.
The painting, the photos in the old motels, where they were, mm-hmm. became more minimal as you went on, which I really felt kind of spatial construct with that minimalism mm-hmm. was much stronger.
Yeah.
You left things out.
Mm-hmm. Well, that was where I was looking at what had been done and documenting that and then changing it myself and documenting that. So it was much more formal. I was interested in kind of spatially and structurally what somebody had created within that space, even if it was just something really small, like the phone and pieces of broken glass. I was interested in why they chose to do that, why was that like that, and then how I could affect that, and then looking at that too. So it was definitely, I was interested in something really different. The multiple exposures were more about what was going on in my head at night when I sleep and how I can interpret that or map it out, but this was much simpler.
It seems like when you went to the metal pouring mm-hmm. kind of vein, it was sort of like a place to recoup, gather ideas, sort of have like an interdisciplinary feeling. But do you feel like you take that process or those ideas within photography and not necessarily combine that, but just it seems like you needed to be there and kind of get away from the photographer for a minute, clear your mind, and then go back to it with like a
it's still a part of how I think as far as making is concerned. I incorporate, there's this part of the program where you, in the foundry department, where you create a proposal for this company that supplies us with all the silica sand and some of the supplies that we need to make things in the foundry, and the company is called Remit. So every year there's a Remit proposal that you do for a grant opportunity to make a piece that you might not be able to afford to make ordinarily. And then they have a big dinner and they give you an award and they get to display your object for a while and then have the opportunity to buy it or not to buy it. So for proposals both those times, I did a proposal which involved photography and sculpture. One of them was creating a room. There were photographs on the wall, there were sculptures, and there was a dining room table. It was, and then another one was some of the photographs of the hotel that I photographed the same thing over time as it was deteriorating and put them on the wall. And then I made cast iron hands that were holding the keys to the motel rooms and place them under the photographs, but they were deteriorating, like pieces of the hands were falling off or they were oxidizing, so they were all rusted as the photographs deteriorated. So I do use both of them at the same time. I just didn't actually make those things. I just did the proposal, so I did a small mock-up of it. So yeah, they live together nicely. All right, well, thanks for letting me talk.
Thank you.